In the terminal methods, let us first see what are the guidelines for terminal methods. The guidelines to be followed here are that the husband's age should be in the range of 25 to 50 years. The wife's age should be in the range of 20 to 45 years. There must be at least a minimum of 2 healthy living children for the couple. If the number of healthy living children is more or equal to 3, then the upper guidelines can be relaxed and there should be spouse consent. So these are the guidelines for undergoing the permanent methods, or which are also called as sterilization. Remember, many a times MCQs are formed wherein they ask you methods of spacing. What we are going to discuss are not methods of spacing. Vasectomy, mini lap operation, or for that matter tubal ligation are not methods of spacing. They are methods of terminal sterilization. So therefore, if an MCQ is asked on which method of spacing has the best success rate and the option is given OCP, that will be the answer. These are not methods of spacing. Coming to the MTP Act, that is the Medical Termination of Pregnancy Act. This is a very important act which is framed in India, and we are very lucky to have this act. There are a lot of countries wherein abortions are illegal or they are prohibited or discouraged. Recently, a case occurred in a foreign land, you should be knowing, and there is a lot of furor because abortion of the lady was not allowed and she died because of the complications. So therefore, in this regard, India is a very progressive country that we have an act such as MTP Act, which lays out rules and guidelines for having safe abortions so that the mothers of India do not die unnecessarily. So what are the conditions under which abortions are allowed? The first one is the medical condition. Medical condition means the mother has severe cardiovascular disease, she has severe renal disease, she has some other disease which is life-threatening if the pregnancy is allowed to continue, and these are called as medical indications. So therefore, the pregnancy can be terminated if a medical condition as such persists. The second condition is eugenic conditions, in which you know prenatally that the child which is going to be born is going to be born with a severe congenital defect, say for anencephaly. In that case, there is no logic in continuing the pregnancy, having a delivery, and then the child is either dead or you hand over a severely handicapped child which maybe is not incompatible with life. So when you have these considerations, those considerations are called as eugenic indications of MTP. The third one is humanitarian. Humanitarian is when this pregnancy could be a result of a rape. In that case, that child would be a reminder of the trauma to the female for a lifelong, and therefore this is a indication. The next indication is socio-economic indication. This is when in the foreseeable future you see that the financial status of the couple is not going to support the child, or the child could be a severe financial burden and it would hamper the child's growth as well as his prospects. In those cases, it is advisable, and that is the socio-economic indication. Lastly, and most uniquely, what is there in the Indian MTP Act is the failure of contraception. I use the word unique because it is really a novel indication. Failure of contraception is very difficult to prove, and it is almost like handing over a clause to the people that they can abort whenever and for whatever reasons, because failure of contraception is very difficult to prove. Any couple can come to you and say that the condom slipped off and this is a pregnancy which is because of failure of contraception. But remember again, the debate on abortions notwithstanding, safe abortion is a definitive right of the female, and thus we have this clause, failure of contraception. Amongst all the clauses, this is the most lax clause. The MTP rule also sets guidelines for where the MTP can occur, who can do the MTP, and till what time the MTP can be done. So let us see first and foremost who can perform the abortion or who can perform the medical termination of pregnancy. I have simplified for you One RMP, that is a registered medical practitioner, can perform an MTP up to 12 weeks of gestation. So the opinion, the expertise of only one RMP is sufficient for up to 12 weeks of gestation. If the pregnancy is carried forward above 12 weeks of gestation, then the opinion of two RMPs is required. Then the opinion of one RMP would not suffice. Above 12 weeks, remember, the opinion of two RMPs is required. Till what time? It can be done till 20 weeks. So remember, here is an important criteria. MTP services are available only up till 20 weeks. After 20 weeks, you cannot do a medical termination of pregnancy. So that is the cutoff where we decide that till 20 weeks MTP is allowable. After 20 weeks, MTP is not allowable. Where can the abortion or the MTP be done? MTP can be done in government authorized centers or government run hospitals. There are certain setups which are formulated by the government, but in public-private partnership they are given out. These centers do not qualify unless and until explicitly allowed by the government. So either it has to be a government run center or a government center itself. So these are the two places you can have the provision of MTP. And remember, wherever you have this provision, abortion is a confidential service. Complete confidentiality of the patient is a must and should be maintained at these centers. Coming to the techniques, male sterilization, which is also called as vasectomy. There is a new concept introduced a couple of years back in India that was called as no scalpel vasectomy. A very small incision was given and vasectomy was done with comparable success rates. So that was a new concept, no scalpel vasectomy. Male sterilization, contrary to the popular belief, is a very good method of contraception. In fact, it is easier than tubal ligation. Tubal ligation needs you to open the abdomen. For male sterilization or vasectomy, even that is not required. So it is a, technically speaking, male sterilization is a minor procedure. Male sterilization is a minor procedure. The complications are few and far between and the results are very good. One of the chief opponents or one of the chief side effects that people complain is the loss of vigor or the loss of libido. And this complaint, when researched, was found to be notwithstanding. This complaint was not valid. Remember, testosterone is responsible for libido. Vasectomy has got nothing to do with testosterone. We are not fiddling with the levels of testosterone. So the so-called maleness is untouched. What we are stopping is just the flow of sperms so that pregnancy is interrupted or pregnancy does not occur. So that is vasectomy, the newer concept I told you, no scalpel vasectomy. It can be done at a PHC level also. There is an important precaution that you should tell the couple that up to 30 ejaculates, the semen can contain sperms. I hope you know by now what is the difference between semen and sperms. Sperms are the haploid cells which fertilize the ovum. Okay, so sperms can be present up to 30 ejaculates and therefore the precaution should be taken that up to 30 ejaculates the couple uses barrier methods of contraception. The most likely method recommended would be the condom again. So that is one important precaution you should tell. Otherwise, vasectomy is bound to fail. Remember this, there can result a pregnancy after vasectomy also. Coming to the complications of vasectomy, you can have operative complications as you have with all the operations. You can have excessive bleeding, you can have secondary infection, you can have localized pain. So these are the general operative complications that we have with almost every surgery. Then you can have sperm granules. These are small beads of hard masses which are essentially made up of sperm. So they are called as sperm granules. They can be mildly painful in some cases and are relieved by the common analgesics. Then you have spontaneous recanalization. You know, human body has a propensity to heal itself and these tubular structures have a propensity to rejoin, and therefore the vast deferens is a tubular structure. It also has a propensity to recanalize, and therefore once it recanalizes, you will have the flow of sperms again reinstated. This can happen very rarely, and this is a complication. In order to prevent this happening, what is done is, if you have this tube, it is cut in the middle and it is not left like that. The ends are everted on both the sides and they are sutured here. What happens is, there is no possibility of recanalization then. So this is the way operatively it is done. But after taking all these precautions, sometimes, very rarely, spontaneous recanalization can still occur. You can have an autoimmune response. If you remember your embryology, sperms have been safeguarded against immunity. There is a sperm blood barrier. Like you have a blood brain barrier, you have a sperm blood barrier, and the blood cells are not allowed to come in contact with the sperms, because these are alien cells for the body. These are haploid cells. We are made up of diploid cells. So if that barrier breaks down, you can have a mild autoimmune reaction, and as we already discussed, the psychological side effects, but those are unfounded. What you should know is, if a male volunteers or if a male undergoes vasectomy, he is allowed of 2 days of vacation in the central jobs. So this can also be asked under what are the facilities which are given. So no scalpel, 2 days of leave. These are the facilities which are afforded for a person who undergoes sterilization, that is vasectomy. Coming to the female sterilization, you have the laparoscopic method, you have a newer method which is the mini lab operation, which is done as the mass approach or mass campaign approach, and these two are fairly successful, very low chances of failure. Ideally, the female is probed to undergo these operations after her delivery. Say for example, she has just had her second child and you are going to counsel her about sterilization, because her family size is complete, and as we already discussed, this is one of those teachable moments. So now the female is receptive about contraceptive advice. For that matter, after the childbirth, the couple is receptive about contraceptive advice. So this can be safely done at this period, because the uterus is up, the fallopian tubes are available after the delivery above the pelvis, and so this can be easily be done. So that use that moment, and female sterilization can be done. It is also called as tubal ligation. The follow up for the health worker. The health worker should follow up this female 7 to 10 days after the procedure, and again at 1 year. So that is the follow up schedule. Again, is a technical bit of information that could appear in the examination. How do we evaluate the success of contraceptive measures? There is an index called as Pearl's index. Please note, Pearl's index is an index which can be asked in the examination, which has been asked in the examination. So Pearl's index measures the failure of contraceptive device, and the formula for Pearl's index is total accidental pregnancies divided by the total months of exposure into 1200. Technically speaking, Pearl's index gives you the number of accidental pregnancies that are bound to occur if 100 females use the contraceptive method for 1 year. To put it otherwise, if one female uses a contraceptive method for 100 years, how many accidental pregnancies will she have? So these are the interpretations of Pearl's index. We will simplify it even more. First, look at the multiplier. The multiplier is very unusual. I am sure you should have noted this. The multiplier is 1200. That 1200 comes from 100 years. How many months are there in a year? I hope you know. And this is the multiplier that you have on your slides right now here. 1200. This is where the 1200 comes from. So if I say that the Pearl's index of a contraceptive method is 10. So therefore, the number of accidental pregnancies for a particular female would be 2.5. How did I come at this? Usually the reproductive period of a female is considered to be 25 years. If the contraceptive method is used for 100 years, I get a failure rate of 10. So for 25 years, I will get 1/4 of 10. 1/2 is 5 and 1/4 is 2.5. So if a female uses this method, she will have 2.5 accidental pregnancies in her 25 years of reproductive span. Again, going back, if I say the Pearl's index is 10, I mean to say there are 10 accidental pregnancies if a female uses this contraceptive method for 100 consecutive years. I hope the interpretation is also clear for Pearl's index. The next in line is life table analysis. It is also used to calculate failure rate for each month of use. So life table analysis is a complex statistical analysis, and it is better than the Pearl's index in calculating failure. There are some other uses of life table analysis also, like the insurance agents uses to calculate the probability of life ahead. So those are some miscellaneous uses, and these are the two methods of evaluation. With this, we complete demography and family planning. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.